Good morning. Today we are going live from Manthan. Beautiful, lovely, green Manthan. Looks lovely. And here is our camp master.
Good morning.
Manju. Manju, what's going on in Manthan today?
We are having a great time finding inner happiness.
Lovely. So anything else you want to add?
And I'm happy to welcome you all to Manthan. Though you're not physically present, but you will get the feel of Manthan also along with your live session.
Right, right. And for a change, we thought we'll do it here from Ali's cottage, and we start bang at 11 a.m. Ali, over to you.
Thank you. Yes, today we are going to be talking about instant gratification. Why do we crave for instant gratification? Why is it that we want something now? You see that happening with toddlers. They say those terrible twos, you know, little kid who's 2 years, 3 years old. When he says that I want chocolate, I want it now. I'm not going to wait. You must have seen that happening so often. But it's okay. For a toddler, you can excuse him saying that he is tiny and he will get over it. But what happens to adults? Why is it that as adults, many of us seem to be wanting to have that instant gratification? When I want something, I want it just not a BK, a B type of dialogues you must have heard in movies. So, let's first start talking about gratification. It's a little unusual word. See, in English language, you always have some fascinating words which are not very clear. People use them in different forms. So what is gratitude? Let's be clear on that, then we'll talk about whatever else. Okay? Gratitude is a pleasurable emotion, or emotional reaction rather, of happiness, fulfillment, joy, in response to fulfillment of some desire or goal. So I have a desire, I have a goal, I'm looking for something, I want something, and when I get that, I feel that sense of happiness or fulfillment, which we refer to as gratification. I feel very gratified that finally I built my house, or I bought that new car, or I got this promotion, or whatever it is. Now the thing is that gratification, aspiring for it, there's nothing wrong. In fact, all of us should be inspiring for some gratification, because only if you do that, you will find that there are other people, you know, who also feel positive towards you, and your life gets better. People who, for example, are not looking for gratification. People are very laid back and they say whatever it is fine, let something come, let something not come. Those are the type of people, you know. It's okay, I have nothing against such people. I truly admire them for the way they, you know, find that joy and fulfillment without aspiring for anything, without asking for something. But my only word of caution is that it is possible that sometime or the other, much later, you will look back and say, hey, I should have got this year. What did I do? I've led my life in a routine manner. I've always helped others. I didn't get anything for myself. And that threat is there. I want you to be aware of it. And then you go ahead. But those of us who want something, those of us who want to progress, those of us who want to, you know, achieve something or whatever it may be, when we get that, as I said, that is that sense of gratification. And very often, it lasts for a very long time. Unless you are a pessimist or unless you are over ambitious every time looking for something new. Gratification is an emotional feeling which actually gets you a lot of joy. You may find pleasure in eating an ice cream. You may find happiness when your child scores well in the exam. But as I said, gratification is when you aspire for something, when you want a fulfillment of your desires or your goals, and that actually happens. That is what is gratitude. Okay. Now, if you are clear on that, let's talk about today's topic, and that is instant gratification, meaning to say, I don't have, patience, I can't wait, I want everything to happen now. I personally feel this thinking towards instant gratification started off, number one, with instant coffee. Before that, most households used to put that coffee in the filter, and that filter had to come down, and then only you can make coffee and serve it. And if you had a certain amount, if some extra guests come, you wouldn't have coffee to give them. And they would also understand that, yeah, we have finished with our coffee filter, and now you'll have to wait, I'll give you something else. The other wonderful thing that happened, all of you are aware, and that is the check coming running and saying, Ma, I'm very hungry. And mummy says, 2 minutes. What was that? Do you recollect those ads? 2 minute noodles. So unlike earlier years where a mother used to tell the child, oh, you're hungry, then I'll make something for you. Go and relax or sit and play some game. It will take me half an hour to make some food for you, and then I will give it to you. But now with things like Maggi noodles available, all that the mother says is 2 minutes, and in 2 minutes of 4 minutes, she actually hands over that eatable, and the child is happy. So that is one of the reasons why we got into this rigmarole or this trap of wanting to have instant gratification. That to say, I want it now, I am not going to wait for it to happen in its own due course. Dr. Sigmund Freud, whom we consider as the father of modern psychotherapy, he very nicely mentioned that it is our id, which is a component of the unconscious mind driven purely by basic instincts. So our basic instincts become so strong, we say that no, I want it now, I deserve it, I cannot wait in queue or waiting for something to happen. And that has gone on and on and on. Whatever used to happen before COVID became 10 times more important, because people were sitting at home and telling Swiggy or Dunzo or whatever it is, you get me this food, you get me that. And they almost like gave assurance that in 13 minutes it will be there. You could even track that person, where has he reached, how far is he, when will he reach here. So see how you got that instant gratification. Now this is a concept which has grown tremendously in this one generation. Even one generation back, like I gave you the example of a child coming back from school and saying, I'm very hungry. The mother loves the child. The mother does not want the child to go hungry. The mother wants to give something, for child to eat. But she said, I have to cook it. I have to go to the kitchen, light the fire, put the oil, do that. Once that is ready, I will feed you with it. Everything was like that. Many of you may not know that even almost 40 years back, home loans were not available. Only people who in the central government or in banking sector or something, because of their profession and because of their being part of that particular establishment, defense forces or whatever it is, only those people could take loans to build a house. Till 40 years back, if anybody wanted to build a house, of course, apartments were hardly there 40 years back, so everybody thought of building an independent house. So what would they do? They would first go hunting for a plot. then that whole process of identifying the right plot, buying it, getting it registered, so much money gone from your pocket. Now you don't have money. Again, you wait, you start saving, maybe take a loan from a family member or do something, and then you say, okay, now I have enough to make myself a 2 BHK house. Then again, I wait. I'm going to retire, I'm going to get my provident fund and gratuity. I'm going to use that and make a first floor on my house so that I can rent it out and I can get that income. Literally, it was a 10, 20, 30 years process of acquiring a roof over your head and getting, you know, a home which you can call yours. Today, you know how it is. You just have to make a phone call and the builder will send his taxi to you, take you to the site, show you around, and if he is satisfied that you are a person with proper means and you are serious about it, the person would say, fine, take your, these are the keys to the flat, take it, keep paying us in installments, EMIs and these things. So what that did was, we have started getting programmed that anything and everything should be, you know, instantly. So when I want something, I do not have the patience to wait for it. This also manifests itself in so many ways. Like there's a queue for something. There's a counter on the other side and there are 15 people in the queue. The 16th man comes and says, by the time these 15 finish, it's going to take me that much time. So very nonchalantly he starts walking past those people, quietly stands for a minute or so, and suddenly he jumps into the queue. And he knows that now, within minutes, my work will be done and I will go away. Such people don't even think of either the ethics or principles of doing such a thing, and also the fact that you are depriving somebody. They have been standing in the queue for such a long time. You are depriving them. So what happens is that people who develop this habit, no, of all the time wanting instant gratification, they are people who are more prone to addictions. Because when they don't get what they want, they want to escape. So a person starts smoking, a person starts drinking, a person goes into drugs or whatever it may be. And of course, the latest addiction being our wonderful smartphone, which has already become smarter than the human beings. We are regressing and the smartphones are going high up all the time. Of late, I've been reading about this 5G and this and that. Though I don't, I'm so out of touch with technology, but the you know, the overall holistic impression that I get is that one by one, we are going to be taken over by these machines, computers and robots. And part of that reason is because we want instant gratification. If I have an employee, and I tell that employee, you get me this, or do this, he will have his idiosyncrasies. He will say, I need to learn first. I'm on my tea break, or it is lunchtime. I'm feeling very tired today. I've done half of it. Tomorrow I will come and do it. But if you have machines, computers, robots, you just don't have to worry about that. They are giving us instant gratification. So right from the days of instant coffee and Maggi noodles, we are more and more into the era where we are being encouraged to have instant gratification. So many of you may have observed in a mall or a restaurant or wherever you are, parents bring a small child and the child starts throwing a tantrum. Now people are turning around and looking. And the parents say, okay, well, stupid fellow, take it. So what are we doing? We are nurturing that instant gratification of the child. The child is still small, still moldable. You can make that child think differently or become more patient. But for my own satisfaction, I am not doing that. Wanting to have instant gratification all the time can also lead to factors like jealousy, anger, high stress levels, one of the most common thing happens to a person who wants instant gratification is his stress levels go up, because obviously you are not going to get instant gratification in everything. You go to, you may be a very rich person, but you go to a government office and ask for some work which is legitimate, which as a citizen it is your right. But that petty official sitting over there wants to throw his weight around and he doesn't do it for you. Then he tells you that it is almost evening, we have to start winding up, you come back tomorrow. He's made you wait for hours and then again he has disappeared. So those are the places where we learn that everything cannot come by instant gratification. And some more signs of the fact that you have got into that instant gratification trap is, if you find yourself in lack of discipline, where you are not doing exactly what needs to be done from time to time, it can distract us from more meaningful pursuits. It can even lead to destructive financial, social and health issues, because we are looking for instant gratification. Take the health sector. Just one or two generations back, there used to be a family physician. Many of them not even MBBS, they may be what you call it, Ayurveds or homeopaths or whatever it is. And they used to have an elaborate consultation where they used to ask you 50 questions and then they would prescribe some medicine and that medicine would take that much time to come. Today you go to the doctor and you demand that day after tomorrow I have an important meeting, please see to it that I am, you know, back on my feet. I am feeling so sick right now. So what does the doctor do? The doctor prescribes medicine which are only symptomatic. We know, the doctor knows that yes, in 48 hours this patient will feel better, so he will be thankful to me, he will keep coming back to me. But what is the long term impact? This is what I am trying to help you understand. Whether it is physical, physiological, health related, whether it is mental health related, becoming a target, succumbing to that instant gratification type of thing can really lead to a lot of issues which you will be sort of, you know, worrying and regretting later. Okay. There is a thing neurologists have been making a lot of progress, as I keep telling you. It's very fascinating to see how much of progress neurology has made in the past few years. They define, neurologists define something called happy hormones. I think that happy is a misnomer. It is actually an instant gratification hormone. We are aspiring for and we are getting something which gives us not exactly happiness but pleasure. Please understand the difference between happiness and pleasure. If I love a particular ice cream or a particular chocolate or a particular movie, if I get an opportunity to eat that or go and watch that, I am getting the pleasure. It is not adding to my happiness. In fact, as I keep reminding about long-term things, it may actually affect me in the long run. Addictions will make me suffer. Always succumbing to instant gratification, I want to do it, I will do it right now. You don't realize the financial implications or even relationship implications at times. These the people who look for instant gratification, they are the type of people who, when to use TA language, transactional analysis, they have come to the conclusion, I am okay, you are not okay. So your fulfillment, your gratification, your happiness is not important. Only me is important. So when I am this great guy who is so macho, so successful, so rich, whatever I am, I want to buy off everything. Every time I aspire to get something instantly by throwing my money, my influence, my power, my status, and I want it to be done immediately, there can be a lot of, what do you say, you know, problems and ripple effect over years and years. The other thing that I just wanted to touch upon, I hate generalizing, but somehow as a counselor dealing day in and day out with people of different ages, I feel the younger generation is far more into instant gratification than the older people. Why? Because older people have already lived in an era where you could not demand anything. Even if you had the money, you could not get something immediately. Take a simple example of the telephone. 30 years back, there were only landline phones. With that dial, you have to put your finger there and dial that thing. And it was a landline, which means it was fixed at one particular place with connected by a wire, and you had to keep it on the table. So when you had to make a call, when you have to receive the call, you had to go and be there at that place physically. Similarly, there was a long waiting list for the telephone department's telephones. I am willing to pay the money, I want a service, a facility which I am entitled to, but they say no, we have only this many, you know, phones are being manufactured or allotted, so you will have to wait. Now, this was an example to show you how people at that generation, why I said that it is the younger people who are more into instant gratification. A young boy and girl wants to have a phone. Does he have to apply to the telephone department and wait for 3 years for his phone to be allotted? No. He goes to whichever the nearest or best mobile phone shop, and he looks at half a dozen of them, narrows down on one and says, yes, this is what I want. And many, very often, he may not even have the money to buy it. It may be an expensive phone costing 60,000 rupees. He may have only 10,000 rupees in his pocket. But what does he do? He puts that 10,000 as down payment and says, I am going to pay EMIs of so much money every month for so many months. But the important thing is, he is carrying that phone home. Morning he made up his mind that I am going to have a phone, and by evening he already has a phone in his hands, and he can carry it anywhere, do whatever he wants. This is only one example I am giving you to help you to understand that very often younger people who have not seen this delay in gratifications, they are really at times getting more and more and more in wanting to have that instant gratification, and their patience levels seem to be really down. Then a simple thing like carrying cash. 20-30 years back, you could buy something only if you have money in your pocket. So you go to a shop, you go to an office, you go anywhere, that person would say, deposit so much money now, then you will get what you want. Now nobody has to wait, nobody has to even go there. Online you book whatever it is, the money gets deducted from your phone or your account, and there you have got whatever you wanted to have. Now, what is happening is that gratitude is internal. It has to come from within. You cannot have gratitude taught to you by others. Yes, if you are still in the growing up stages, if you are still open to it, people can give you examples, like how I've been doing. People can tell you what are the areas and, you know, what are the long-term consequences. It's a great an awareness. But whether you have, you know, that gratitude and gratification is not, you know, entirely up to yourself. Gratification specifically is more to do with others. When I get something from others, then I am fulfilled. Suppose I have money. I know I have the money, I want to buy a huge fancy TV. I go to the place, order the TV and it comes. Compared to that, if my elder brother says, I've got a bonus and I know that you have a very old and small TV. I thought, for this new year, I will gift you a fancy phone. The gratification you get there is far more, because you realize that your brother took the trouble, was sensitive to understand your needs, put aside money from whatever bonus and all he got, and ensured that you get a nice TV. The interesting thing about this is that we always want instant gratification, but when it comes to our own responsibility, we tend to procrastinate. When I have to do something for somebody else, I start thinking 10 times, I start giving myself excuses as to why I'm not doing it. But from others, I want it immediately and right now. I remember long back there was this RJ in one of the FM radios who used to say, I want happiness fatafat. I want a motorbike fatafat. I want love fatafat. Imagine, you know, placing an online order that please Swiggy deliver some nice love for me. I am desperate about it. How many of us actually put our thought to these things? Okay. Now, if you are at even partially convinced that instant gratification is not a good thing to happen, let me give you a few simple points as to how to overcome, how to bring it down, how to go back into that era of, you know, delaying gratification. If you are a person who can envision your desired future, then even if you are not getting something now, if you have this habit looking at the future, that eventually I want this, eventually I want to work towards that. If I do that, then what I am not getting today does not really matter to me. And if you find that you cannot have a vivid picture about your future, your goals, then your motivation level is poor. You have to do something about it. People who have high EQ, emotional intelligence, they are the ones who can delay gratification. Build up your EQ. We have some nice literature booklets. You can Google and see how you can build up your emotional intelligence. Also, break down your tasks into small, manageable ones. So I am very hungry. He is going to take so much time to deliver the pizza for me. I have a biscuit packet. I can open that and eat it. I will feel comfortable. Let that fellow come after half an hour, 1 hour also. It doesn't make a difference. Record the occasions when you avoided instant gratification and see the joys and pleasures you got out of it. Empathize with others. Find out what difficulties they are going through. And then you will be able to empathize if they don't give you something immediately. It could be a loved one who, from whom you are demanding something, and that person says, no, I'm very tired or I'm busy and I can't do this. It could be the poor Swiggy fellow, you know, who gets caught in the rain and who has a puncture and he cannot deliver to you. This empathy factor plays a great role in understanding what is delayed gratification. The other thing is to take holidays. from your work, from your responsibilities. If you are a homemaker, take a holiday from your home and your family. The more you do that, the better it is going to be. And the final, you know, bottom line, as they would say, is learn from nature. Nature teaches you so much about delayed gratification. You put a seed, even if you are willing to put tons of fertilizer and water and do the weeding and everything, if that crop takes 3 months to ripen, it will take 3 months. You have no chance over it. More you spend time in nature, easier it will be for you to understand what the thing is all about, and to be able to actually develop that feeling of, you know, telling yourself that it's okay to delay gratification. So right now you'll have to delay your gratification by a couple of minutes. I'm going to take a quick break. As you saw just now, Seema is back. She was in Delhi all this while. She's come back, so it's a pleasure to have her. And of course, the camp master of Manthan is
Manju.
Here. Just tell you a few things and I'll be back in a couple of minutes.
Sure, Ali. We'll go down and show them what's happening around in Manthan. We'll be back in 2-3 minutes. Yeah.
How's here?
Enjoying FB Live and all the activity which other participants are doing. There is an activity going on there, the amphitheater. Ali's Cottage, where today we are going live. Beautiful and serene. Classroom, that's the stage. There's a nice little pond here. These are the dormitories. It's a beautiful place, yes, Vidya, absolutely. Manju, so this is Manthan 50. 62. 62, wow.
62.
Awesome, awesome. So what happens exactly, Manju, in Manthan?
Here we do assemble for 2 days. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of introspection sessions. We have activities. We have fun along with a campfire. And there's a lot of learning and fun happens in these 2 days.
Yes.
So we can see there, we have an activity happening over there.
Right.
In the auditorium.
There are auditoriums, classrooms, cafeteria, in the midst of all this greenery and beauty. Just forget everything else in the world and just come here and enjoy the serene environment. Kanaka is busy with an activity here. That's the preparation for the evening. There's an activity. We don't want to disturb them. Meera and Kanaka are conducting an activity. All right. So we start moving back to the live. In the meantime, all your questions, please type in there. Ali will be addressing those shortly. What a life, na? These guys have. We'll go back to Ali's cottage. It's a wonderful, wonderful Manthan. All right, so we we will go back up and we will continue our discussion on this wonderful topic, delayed gratification. So please put in your questions, and we are back to Ali. Yes, Ali.
Hi, I'm back. I also love to delay gratifications, get things on time, but sometimes my curiosity takes over. So whenever I'm speaking for this first half hour, the immediate thing I want to know is what are your comments and what are your questions on that, because I learn so much from it. So today, since I have not brought our laptop here, I am requesting Manju to read out your statements or your questions, and I will see how best I can answer them for you.
Surekha has mentioned, if we don't want to be average, then we should not rush into doing what the herd is doing. Self-discipline is the key.
Absolutely, Surekha, you are absolutely right. Only right that I will add to it is, what is definition of average? You know, a person who says that I will do a simple clerical job and I will earn enough to give 2 square meals to my family, he could be average. A CEO can say that I am average because I am the CEO of such a small company. I should have been the CEO of a big company. So right now I am an average person. But yes, without going into the nitty-gritty of average, whatever you said, I 100% agree with you.
Sai Kumar is there, Ali. He told, Ali, I finally made it. Virtual is better than nothing. Nostalgia.
Absolutely, absolutely. For many, many, many years, my very dear friend, Dr. Sai Kumar, former professor of medicine in Chennai, he used to come regularly for our Manthan camps. Of late, due to other circumstances, he is not able to make it to come all the way to Bangalore. But as you rightly said, Doc, at least virtually you are here with us today, and I am very happy about it. So one of the things is, even if you look at it in this manner, that when you have a need, let's say Dr. Sai Kumar loves to come to Bangalore and spend 2 days in a month and then goes back. If he is not able to fulfill it, what are the alternatives that can be done? One of the good ways to ensure that you don't get caught in this instant gratification trap is to keep looking and exploring at alternatives. There are so many alternatives. And starting with children, I think we have to teach these children. But if the child says, I want this pizza right now, I want this ice cream right now. If the elders say, no, you are not getting it, child can get very upset. But if you say something as simple as, no, I'm not buying you pizza, but if you want, we'll get a good chocolate or we'll get some nice sweet which all of us can enjoy. So one is to delay the gratification. Pizza will come only on Sundays. During weekdays, we don't order pizza. So you're teaching him to wait till it comes to Sunday. His excitement will be going up. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, he would feel happy with it. He hasn't got the pizza, but he's very happy knowing that on Sunday I'm going to get my pizza. And in the meanwhile, I'm not being brushed aside. I'm not being told, you stupid fellow, why you want pizza every time, get lost. No. My parent very clearly told me, we have a simple norm in our family that we order this outside food only on holidays or weekends. So being a weekday today, I will make some nice food, if you want this, if you want that, and after that also, if you want an ice cream, maybe I'll buy that for you. This really helps in building up that delayed gratification thing among
Surekha has asked, Ali,
yeah,
how can we stop trying to shape others and focus on our own weaknesses?
Oh yes, in fact that's what we have doing in this camp right now. Surekha, the title is Finding Inner Happiness. So instead of focusing on others, these 2 days we are focusing only on our own self. right from our early childhood, what were the joys and what were the gratifications that we received as children, what were the setbacks also, and today as an adult, what am I doing, what am I aspiring for, what am I getting or not getting. These are all simple habits. First time you are trying to do something, it doesn't work. You feel very self-conscious, you lose your patience after a little while. But if you are consistent, if you constantly make sure that I am going to reprogram myself in order to do this, and this is very important if you have children at home or if you are, even if you are interacting with children, we have to be a role model of delayed gratification. You are all aware that children do not listen to their elders, they only mimic their behavior. So if I can say, yes, I am somehow feeling like eating pizza, and that so and so pizza place is very nice, I'm getting tempted, I should order, but no, today is Tuesday, no? We have to wait till the weekend. I will not order a pizza today. So the child is looking at the parent and saying, yes, my parent has the ability, the resources, but my parent has learnt that you have to follow certain discipline. This is how we teach this thing to children.
Vidya is asking, to what extent should we ignore other unwanted comments and when to react?
Oh yes, somebody makes an unwanted comment, meaning to say somebody has been critical about you. First thing is, do not react. Learn to respond. That's also part of this instant gratification. If we get into the trap of instant gratification, the moment somebody says something to me, you says, what Ali, this stupid the coat that you are wearing, it doesn't suit you. If I am a reactive person, if I am a person who wants instant gratification, I will immediately turn around and say, you think this t-shirt is looking good or not? What a sense of dressing you've got. Now what was the issue? The issue was that he was trying to tell me that my coat or my blazer is not good. So one is take time. Respond and not react. So let it sink in. Say 1 minute, give some excuse, I'll just go to the washroom and come. Or I'll just send off this message and then I will talk to you. So that delay actually makes you respond instead of reacting. And the best way of responding is, whenever somebody makes this unwanted criticism or whatever you say, all I have to do is to ask him, what is it about this coat that you don't like? Is it the color? Is it the fitting? Is it the texture? That puts the onus on the person to back up whatever he or she said about the unwanted comments that the person made. So, if you find that the person is brushing you off, oh, you're just a stupid coat here, why do you want to wear that? Then I know that he's not genuine. If he tells me that, you know, in our Bangalore weather or in this, you get coats which are like this and like that, this type would be better, this color suits you better if you have a different color. That's why I told. Whenever somebody can back it up, be extremely thankful to him, because it is the constructive criticism which people give us which makes us improve and grow. So learn to differentiate between these two type of people and respond accordingly.
Sonal wants to know, what about adults expecting immediate change in child's behavior?
Yes, thanks for putting that across, Sonal. And you as the head of Gurukul are aware of these things. You are obviously dealing with it day in and day out. The point is, please tell elders who are dealing with children. It need not be only parents. So many adults influence children. It could be grandparents, it could be extended family, It could be teachers. Just this morning I was telling our group about how there are teachers. There's a recess. Children go out to play. 15 minutes later the bell rings and they are supposed to run inside and get in. The teacher has come 1 minute before and is sitting down ready to start the lesson. There are 40 children in the class, but only 25 have turned up. The other 15 are still playing and just winding up or whatever it is. I know of teachers, unfortunately, who will look at these 25 and say, where are your friends? What are they doing? They want to keep playing all the time. They don't want to learn, is it? If they delay like this, how will I complete the portion? Now the teacher is firing the children who came back on time. And those who are doing the offense of not coming back, they don't even hear about it. They are, by the time they walk in, they listen. Would have started. So there are ways and means by which we need to inculcate this in children by being a role model. So like I said, you may be a parent, you may be a counselor, you may be a teacher, you whatever you are, you can influence children primarily through role modeling. I keep giving this example every time to people that whatever you do consistently and do it with evaluation, children pick it up very fast. Let's take an example. You are a vegetarian family, you do not eat non-vegetarian food. Child is growing up, he sees his friends going to some KFC, this, that. And he comes and says, I also want to go there. What's wrong with it? You normally take it easy and make the child sit down and say, yes, your friends eat non-veg food. They enjoy it. Good luck to them. We are not saying that they are wrong and we are right or something. But it our family norms, it is our value system, it is whatever you want to call it, that we don't eat. And then the child sees that when they have gone to the party, father's boss is saying, hey, try this out, man. Just eat this chicken and see. You never eaten, no, it'll be so wonderful. And who is saying that? The boss. But daddy turns to him and says, thank you very much, sir, but I'm a pure vegetarian, I don't eat. The impact of that on the child is amazing. And the child will follow whatever you are asking.
Sai Kumar has commented, let not the instant impact dissipate instantly. Carry it out in practice what you have learned.
Absolutely. This is something which I am a strong believer in. I have told how many times we have these sessions. We are having this today camp in Manthan. I am having this 1 hour session with you on FB Live. I am not saying that whatever I have to is absolutely perfect and the gospel truth or anything like that. I am only saying that out of everything I say or you find out from Google or you read in a book or you have a teacher or guru who can say something to you, whenever that happens, please evaluate it. Think about it, whether this is right or wrong. And if you are even 10% convinced, put it into practice. That's what we do in our counseling courses, no? Those of you who have attended the DCS program. For example, we insist on this thing of being non-directive. And immediately there are people who say, if a counselee comes to me to solve a problem, and I'm only going on saying, nodding my head, won't she get angry? But the fact is, you have to practice it to know how it is. There are ways and means where you convince a person that you are paying attention, you are involved, and you are concerned for her. But it is her life, so I am not going to give the solution that empower you to do it. The same thing applies over here.
Surekha Raj, there is a big difference in living in the moment and living for the moment. How can we help ourselves realize that we can't always have what we want and still be happy and healthy?
Absolutely. You brought out a very nice and subtle difference between living in the moment and living for the moment. Today, just take a thing. Normally on Saturdays, I'm in that closed room, the studio, you know, nothing around me, and I'm talking to you. Today, even though you are not here physically, you get the feel of what we are enjoying over here. Can you look around and see that when I am in nature, which teaches us so much about delayed gratification, I feel that joy and that thing. But again, you can't once in a year go for a 3-day vacation to a hill station and come back and say, I've done everything for the family. It has to be on a continuous basis. And like I said, nobody can teach you to delay gratification more than nature. Be it bird, be it anything. So I said about, you know, living in the moment and living for the moment. Just hear out these birds who are chirping so happily. Are they discussing that we will get food tomorrow? Are they discussing that when I grow old, will I have a pension and will I be taken care of? Are they discussing that, you know, such and such relative is ignoring me? Nothing of that sort. They're so happy, so thrilled by being in the moment. They must have been flying somewhere. They saw this huge patch of greenery and they said, come, let's go there. And they are here. Tomorrow, for whatever reason, they feel that, yes, I have seen this enough. I need some variation. I need to go into something different. Without batting an eyelid, without packing up their baggage, without buying a train ticket or plane ticket, they just fly away wherever they want. And when they go to their new place, it may not be as good as the old place. They still accept it. And they still keep moving. These are the wonderful things which happen every time.
Swapna is telling, hi Ali.
Hi.
Wonderful topic. Sometimes we seem as fools waiting in the queue when somebody is rushing.
Yeah. That is what I have been telling you. That the long-term impact of delayed gratification. Yes, at that moment, you have already stood in the queue for 15 minutes and you are the sixth person and somebody casually walks in and joins in the third person's place and he gets his stuff and he walks out. I agree with you, sir, that at that moment you may feel like a fool. But what I am trying to say is, look at the issue holistically. One day, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, 10 years from now, when you look back and say, let the world do anything, let people jump queues, let people, you know, cheat each other, let people go into violence or whatever they are doing. My conscience is clear. I know that I am doing this. Just because somebody cut into my queue yesterday, today I don't go and cut into somebody's queue saying everybody is doing that. This is a very funny thing which I keep noticing every now and then. There will be some road which is quite narrow and congested. So the police puts up a board, no parking, so that vehicles can move smoothly. Before you know it, there will be so many cars parked there. The others have parked and gone away. You are just parked or you have just come back and you are starting car. And the traffic police officer turns up. I have seen so many people arguing by saying, in sir, look at the others, so many are here, you are not saying anything to them, you are saying something to me. Isn't that foolish? I have committed an offense. I have to acknowledge it. If I am a responsible citizen who wants to live by the law, by the constitution of the country, and by moral values, I have to accept. Legally, the police has put up a sign saying it is no parking. For my convenience, instead of going half meter ahead, I parked over here. So, I have to pay the fine because I am short. The second thing is, why was the rule put up? Because there should be a smooth flow of traffic. If people park over here, then the traffic will get filled up. So, there is a meaning in what they have done. As a concerned citizen, do I go go into that and understand that and accept these things, this is very important.
Sonal has commented for your previous discussion. True, Ali, even with children, when we practice non-directive counseling, it has a long-term empowerment effect.
Absolutely.
Patience and consistency.
Absolutely, absolutely. That's what I keep reminding all of us adults, that please do not take children for granted. I know of parents who say simple thing. They've got a toddler at home and they say, my daughter does not eat food unless I put that cartoon network and hand her over the phone. And you tell them that she is very small. This is not the right time for her to throw tantrums. Why can't you mold her? No, she won't listen to me. The other day, you know, when I said no phone and you eat, she went to that table, picked up the phone and threw it down. It broke. Now, isn't that a dangerous thing? Aren't you bringing up a monster by giving up into the thing? If you have to teach delayed gratification. Just the other day, one of my friends was saying that when her son was very small and would refuse to eat food unless his mobile, you know, whatever distraction is there. She used to take him into the balcony, put a small table, put the food over there, come inside and bolt the door. And she would say, take whatever time you want, but when you finish the food, I will allow you inside. She said initially he threw a lot of tantrums. He started banging the door and trying to break the glass. I ignored. I said, this is what it is. You need this food. You have to eat it. And she said, it was just a matter of few days that the child learned. And then the child told me, can I sit here on the table and eat? I will not ask for the phone or the TV. I will sit. And that is when the mother told the child, yes, I also love you. I would like to spend time with you on the dinner table. So that's a wonderful thing. We will chat, we will discuss, we will pray, whatever you feel like.
We'll take our last question.
Yes.
Handling by Surekha. Handling recurrent frustration at managing an expectation makes the delaying of gratification a tough task.
True.
How do we manage our feelings of letting ourselves down?
Yeah, correct. Very true. When you said that it is a tough situation, let me tell you that whatever topics we take up, and we spend so much time, not only I spend time preparing, come with what the points, and then I share that with you. Then in the second hour, we have so many things which, you know, we talk, we get different types of comments and different types of questions. I'm taking up topics which is tough. If there is a topic of something which is very easily done, you would have been able to do it. You won't waste 1 hour here being this every life. So understand that tough, difficult is not the same as impossible. Keep that in mind. Work towards it. Maybe make a team with one or two friends or family members and say that, come on, let us, you know, help each other. Talk to each other and find out how we can help each other. Record, you know, where I was a little apprehensive, or I was a little impulsive rather, and I wanted that thing myself. Can I be a role model to the younger generation? Can I be consistent in telling those children that whatever you do, you are not going to get this. Have to delay the gratification. You will be a great service to yourself, your family members, and whichever children you are in touch with. So, we continue over here in this beautiful climes of Manthan. And I will be seeing you next Saturday at 11 o'clock back into our studio on the topic, how to say no. Veda. It's something which is so difficult to some people, exactly what Surekha was saying, that some of us find it extremely difficult to say that no. And that is the reason why I am going to be discussing that with you. you also research, find out what are the good ways, bad ways, how do you manage to say no when you don't want to oblige a person. And we'll meet next Saturday and we'll have a lively discussion on it. Till then, enjoy yourself, enjoy life, and enjoy the abundance of nature that there around. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.
Sayaj expressed Ali, this made his day.
Wonderful.
Lovely. Thank you everybody for joining in. Lovely topic next week. So see you then. Bye. One look at Manthan before we end today's session.